Holy ground medley. Stand if you can. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in His presence on holy ground. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is present, and where He is holy. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is present, and where He is holy. These are holy hands. He's given us holy hands. And so these hands are holy. These are holy hands. He's given us holy hands. He works through these hands, and so these hands are holy. We are saved. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in His presence on holy ground. Set my soul afire, Lord, for Thy holy word. Burn it deep within me, let Thy voice be heard. Millions grope in darkness in this day and hour. Set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of Thy saving power. Millions grope in darkness, waiting for Thy word. Set my soul afire, Lord. Set my soul. For the lost in sin, give to me a passion as I seek to win. Help me not to falter, never let me fail. Fill me with set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. Millions grope in darkness, waiting for thy word. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. Set my soul afire, Lord, in my daily life. Far too long I've wandered in this day of strife. Nothing else will matter but to live for thee. I will be a witness, for Christ lives in me. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. Make my life a witness of thy saving power. Millions grope in darkness, waiting for thy word. Set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart. Lord, I want to be more holy in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more holy in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more holy in my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart.
Well, it is good to be back. I've missed a few Sundays, and I don't like it when I miss. I don't know how you are, but I like it when I can come and worship and be with my brothers and sisters in the Lord. I want to take the time, though, to thank you for their prayers for me and my health. Things are moving along all right. I stayed home for just some minor things and a lot of illnesses that were going on at the time. So I felt that was best. As far back as I can remember, being a little boy, I was always told when I wasn't behaving right that God's watching. He's got an eye on you. He knows when you're lying. He knows just what you're doing. And I don't think it was done out of any meanness, maybe a lack of knowledge of a real relationship. But I grew up with that big eye in the sky mentality of a God just waiting to pounce on me. And you know, that's not the relationship he wants with us. His eyes are on us. His ears are on hearing us. And his hands supply so many of our needs that we take for granted. He wants to have that relationship with us that when we do err, we realize we broke his heart. And that cuts a little deeper than just the big eye in the sky mentality. That we broke his heart. So let's encourage them, that eye, to be honest, because he watches our footsteps and where we go and what we do. And let's keep praying because he hears our prayers. I can tell you from my point of view, exactly. He hears me when I pray. And his hands are there to help us through. That's what this song is going to be about today. It's going to be about what he really does for us. And you can come up now. In a good way, in a relationship way, in the way that he means it to be. Not the big eye in the sky, but a great loving God that wants to give us grace to get us through those tough times in our lives and those challenges in our lives that we have. The eyes of Jesus.
Sometimes it seems God's a million miles away, too busy for a creature such as I. And then I think of how he sees each barrel fall. I call on him and find that he is nigh. The eyes of Jesus are upon each footstep that I take. His ears are always. Heavy load, his heart is broken every time I stray. In valleys low, I look toward the mountain high and praise the Lord that caused this world to be. To think a God so great would hold me safe within his arms. What love that he take. His ears are always open when I pray. His hands are always there to help me lift my heavy load. His heart is broken every time I stray. His heart is broken every time I stray.
Turn with me to James chapter 2. We are continuing in the book of James.
And now, believe.
I'm not sure what this sermon is brought to you by, but later you'll hear that commercial. But anyway, as we go through James, there's a couple things I'm gonna talk about in a second. You should have gotten a handout. If you didn't, it's okay. You can get one on your way out. You won't need it for the whole sermon, but... But one of the things that I have an interesting sense of humor, and I've come to believe that is an inherited trait from God, because I believe God has an interesting sense of humor about things. And one of the things that happened just now is that we've been talking in James about how trials are there to help you grow, and it's not that God has brought them upon you necessarily. But it's that he's trying to demonstrate something that is missing or something that needs to change. This morning, as I was getting ready to come up and we were singing worship, I realized that I had a giant technological failure and I don't have my sermon. But it's okay, because we have the Bible and I have a voice and I'm very familiar with what I'm preaching. It's just kind of funny because My ADHD is used to having the screen there, so that whenever I turn away too soon, I can look down and see where I'm supposed to be. So today, if you see me do this, just because I forgot, I don't have it with me. But it's okay. Hopefully you put the foil on the pot roast. I put it that way. So it's kind of an inside joke, but y'all probably get it anyway. But I do want us to open up in prayer, and then we're going to kind of get started. I do want to make sure I have the bulletin with me at least, so that way it doesn't get too crazy. But let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the day. We thank you for your servant James, who wrote this letter to us, and even though it has difficulties with it, we know that it's just a reflection of the difficulties of life, and that the wisdom that's there, it comes from you. And if we're willing to listen, if we're willing to pay attention, then we can also grow in the life that you have for us. Lord, I pray for this message. I do ask that it's not my words, it's not my failures, it's your words to us. Lord, it's your words to me, that time and again, no matter how many times I read this letter, I always just think, Lord, what else are you showing me? Lord, show us today through your Holy Spirit and through reading of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So a couple things as we kind of go into it. I've talked about kind of the structure of James. It's more akin to Jewish wisdom literature. So if you actually read James and then look back at like Ecclesiastes and Proverbs, you see some similarities in the structure there, and that's on purpose. James is giving wisdom to the new church, and he's doing this in a very Jewish way, because spoiler, James is Jewish. He's the brother of Jesus. We talked about that, and so he grew up hearing the stories. He grew up hearing the law and the prophets and all that. And so he also grew up disbelieving that Jesus was who he said he was. It wasn't until the resurrection that James was like, oh, you are the Messiah. So he gives us this letter, though. And Bruce, if you go back one more slide, what you'll see is it's kind of a mess, right? And that's why you have this here. For those of y'all wondering, this is what happens when you let graphic designers and artists do a Bible outline. This is what you get. For those of y'all that are like, I don't like this, this makes me very uncomfortable to look at it, that's okay. You are in what's known as the left brain category of things. You're in that type A. Everything has to be organized and orderly. Modernity was good for you. Not for those of us with that are more right-brained. I think this is great. Just for those of y'all wondering, like, how weird is your pastor? This, to me, I was like, this is great, which is why I'm showing it to you. But there's a lot of different ways to outline. And I bring that up because literally I have four different commentaries on my shelf on James and four different outlines for the book of James. And so if you're kind of wondering, like, as you're reading it, if you're thinking, man, this guy really seems to bounce around all over the place, well, that's because he kind of does. And we talked about that, right? Chapter one is very much an introductory chapter, and you get those big statements, you know, rejoice when trials come upon you and that sort of thing. And you're just like, okay, that's some hard-hitting stuff. And then chapters 2-5, there's a lot of, well, didn't he already say this? Well, he did. He's expounding on it. So as we start reading in 2 and 1, we're going to read 1-13 today, but we'll start with 1-7. But what you see is this kind of repetition and reinforcement. Now, for those of y'all that don't like this, right, the next slide, this is kind of my way of kind of filtering it all down, because I'm a big believer in what's the main point, right? What is the one thing that God is teaching us? And then all the little details tend to fall under this one thing. And what we see, and I don't know if you can read this or not, but it's okay if you can't. But the big red banner, right, the overarching thing that we're coming to walking away from James is wisdom reveals the salvation process, right? We talked about this. Salvation is a process, right? Yes, once you're saved, you're saved. But it's not that, well, you turned your life to Christ, you got baptized, and then you're done. No, you surrendered to Christ, you were baptized as that first step, right, of obedience, and that begins a lifetime of growing in that salvation. And eventually you get to heaven, and that's good, right? But I also kind of believe that once we get to heaven, we're probably not done there. We have all eternity with God. I feel like we'll learn some more stuff when we get there too, right? So, but what James is wanting to help us understand, in the green you see that godly wisdom is available, right? That's why he says, if any of you lack wisdom, in chapter 1, what should you do? You should pray to the Lord. Ask God, who gives generously, right? He gives generously to all. So if you lack wisdom in some area, then you should ask for that. And some of those things that kind of pop up later in James is godly wisdom. It opposes earthly wisdom. It's recorded in Scripture. It's experienced through action, right? We don't just like hear God's voice. We don't just read the Bible and we're like, okay, I've got it. But we actually, when we put it into action, we really experience it and we understand it better. And then also it is found through prayer. And James talks about the power of prayer and how that enables some of those actions. And then the flip side, right, that's kind of threaded with this is on that right side, the blue, where trials reveal this process. Why is it that bad things happen to good people? Why is it that God allows these things to happen, right? Because James does say, if any of you are tempted, don't blame God. It's not God tempting you. He doesn't tempt anybody, nor is he tempted by evil. But we are tempted when we're led astray by those selfish desires. And so part of why trials happen to us, it is a disciplining process in that God is allowing this thing to happen because you messed up and that's something that needs to happen. But also, sometimes it's not necessarily that we did something wrong. It's just there's a character trait that's not quite right just yet. And when one imperfect person rubs up against another imperfect person, that's when these things start happening. And we'll read in later chapters about what happens when jealousy starts having these fights and quarrels among you. We'll get to that later in James. You'll love that one, I'm sure. So, but those trials reveal this process, right? And it reveals where things are deficient, whether that be in us or in the world around us. One of the things we're going to talk about today is the socioeconomic status of things. Why do we have rich and why do we have poor? Why do we have this? You know, why are there different modes of life? Why are there people that seem to be doing really well and they don't seem to have a lot of problems? And there's those of us that struggle all the time, right? Why is it that one kid can get straight A's in class but I'm doing good to get a C, right? I was the kid that got straight A's, so, you know, I'm reflecting my brother. He always gets A's. Well, grow smarter. But that's brother, not pastor, just brother talking. But that's, you know, but it's why do these things happen? Well, because there's deficiencies in us. And it's not, again, it's not always necessarily a bad thing. It's just that God is revealing something that's not quite right. Because if you recall, right, he says in verse 1-4, let steadfastness have its full effect that you may be perfect and complete. All right, if you believe you are perfect and complete, I have news for you, you're not. And what those trials in life do is they reveal those times where, oh, I'm not as perfect as I thought I was. And so we grow from that. Right? James is going to bring up lawsuits, which we'll actually talk about today a little bit. He brings up those fighting, and he brings up health problems as well. The tail end of James is about what to do when sickness comes upon you. So that's how all these kind of things interweave. But what it boils down to in the big gold square that I don't know if you can read, it's wisdom. It informs our responses to daily trials. So this is why I love the book of James. For those of you that have ever wondered, what does the Bible that was written in, you know, first century or even before Christ, you know, 1,000 years before Christ, what does that have to do with 21st century life? Well, books like James, it everything. Because the problems that humans have today have not changed in thousands upon thousands of years. They just look different. We may not be running away from bears and other various assorted things unless you go camping, but we still have problems that chase us. We still have deficiencies in our character. As much as we like to think we're evolved human beings, the fact of the matter is we're not. So that's where James puts us today, right? So what we're looking at today then, right? So wisdom informs our response to daily trials. We're going to read in chapter 2, 1 through 7. And the big lesson for today that I want to go ahead and give you in the top of your bulletin, true godly love is unconditional and impartial, right? So what is the teaching? What is it that James is revealing to us about God? Well, he's telling us that God's love, in the true sense of the word, it is unconditional and it is impartial. And for those of y'all that didn't catch that, that's a good amen moment, because I want you to think about that for a second. If God's love to us was conditioned on anything that we did, right, or anything that we avoided doing, how many of you would be worthy of it? Yeah, I'm glad we're all on the same page there, because that would have been a whole different sermon if anybody said, well, I deserve God's love. Right? No, you don't. Right? None of us do. That's why it's good news. That's why it's grace, because we don't deserve it. In fact, as lost people, we've done everything in our power to not deserve it, and yet God gives it anyway. And it's impartial. I think it's very important that like I said before, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach. This is kind of one of those interesting things to think about, right? God's wisdom is available to all without reproach, meaning that God will give it to you and he's not going to get on to you for asking for it. God's grace is given to anyone who is willing to receive it. God's love is given to anyone who's willing to receive it. God's wisdom is given to anyone who is willing to receive it. The catch there is we have to be willing to receive it. And that's where the rubber hits the road for a lot of us, because are we really willing to hear what God has to say and not just, you know, make ourselves feel better about our faults? This is where we land today. So true godly love is unconditional and impartial. Let's read chapter 2. We're going to read 1 through 7 to begin. My brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, you sit here in a good place, while you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit down by my feet, have you not then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich the ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name by which you are called? So James gives us a direct lesson right off the bat, right? Verse 1, it's pretty hard to miss. My brothers, and that's sisters too, that's a generic one, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. It's pretty straightforward, right? Like, you don't really need to know the Greek to understand what that means. Show no partiality, right, as you go about your day. And notice he says also, right, that as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. I think it's very significant that James uses that full title there, because he's tying together a few different things, but the bottom line is this: the God who created this universe, who revealed himself through the Old Testament, the God who gathered these people out of Egypt, that brought Israel along the way, those you know, couple thousand years of Jewish history where God is building a nation, and then he reveals himself in Christ, that God comes to us and walks among us and teaches us and lives a sinless life, lays that life down on the cross, and then is resurrected, right? that Lord of glory, that glory, that Shekinah glory, the Lord who led his people through the wilderness, right? Cloud by day, fire by night. That Lord, he says, when you hold faith to him, show no partiality. And why is that significant? Well, think about it. No one is more important than Jesus, right? Can you imagine, can you think of anybody that has ever walked this earth that is more important than Jesus? Well, no, because he's God's son. He's the most important thing. And yet, Jesus treated everyone equally. And in fact, he made himself a servant, right? He gave up all rights that he had as Lord of heaven and earth and came and was born in a manger. He was born in a very small podunk town of all places. And he lived this life of a carpenter's son. And then he lays that life down. And the one who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who should have been treated with the highest of honor, is beaten and ridiculed and spat upon. And yet, in all that he does, he says, you know what? I love all of you equal. From the richest to the poorest, black, white, everything in between, right? The old song, you know, they are all precious in his sight, red and yellow, black and white. And Jesus, who had every right to show partiality and say, you know what? I think I like this guy better than that guy over there. He said, no, 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 it's all equal. You might have heard it said that the ground at the cross is level. It's not a geography lesson. Golgotha is a hill. It's not level. What it's saying is that everyone can approach Christ equally. And so if the Lord of Lords says, I am not going to show partiality, I am going to treat everyone, right, equally, then for God's people to say, well, I like this person better, or I like that person better, or this person does not deserve grace, that person does not deserve mercy, that is the highest of sins, James is going to say here in a second. So that's where we're at. No one is more important than Jesus, and Jesus treated everyone equally. Right, and he gives this illustration of coming into assembly. It's kind of a fun little word here, assembly, because just by a show of hands, how many of you heard this preached that he's talking about like in a church service or like in a Christian gathering? Anybody? Nobody's heard that? I heard that growing up throughout my whole life. That makes me want to wonder what y'all heard it. Okay, so the assembly then, right, this word here is actually what we would literally translate as synagogue. So this is where they would have their Jewish services, obviously, but also this is where they would deal with lawsuits and arguments with one another, right? So if I made you mad, or I took a cow or something or whatever else, right? If something I did, right, that was wrong, if you wanted to bring me before the courts or bring me before the authorities, this is where we would go. And what's interesting about this is James is really pointing out the giant hypocrisy of these particular people. Because notice what he says, right? He says, if a rich man comes in and you say, come have this great seat, but a poor man, you tell him to go sit by your feet, right? And this is in a court. And then he says later, are not the rich ones who oppress you and drag you into court? Right? If we think back to the background of James, right? He's dealing with a very persecuted church from both Jews and from Romans. And it's kind of, and we think to ourselves, how could this happen? How is it that people who are actively being oppressed, who are actively being ridiculed, they're coming into this courtroom, but then the very ones that are oppressing them, they're saying, let's pay you good honor. Let's treat you well. And we think, how in the world does that happen? Well, it happens because I think a lot of times we're just short-sighted as people. And unfortunately, Christians are people, and we get short-sighted as well. I think in Baptist denomination, right, we've got a lot of politics going into play, and we bow down to political figures, or we try to align ourselves with political figures. I am not against Christians taking part in politics, but I am against Christians marrying politicians and being not marrying in the sense of like this man, this wife, but in the sense of I'm going to align what I believe about Scripture and the church with this politician. I have a giant problem with that. The problem there is that there's a reason church and state should be separated, right? And for those of y'all like, well, that's kind of hard hitting. Well, think about this. Every time a local church, I don't know how many times I've heard of so-and-so in a church will say, well, I'm not going to tithe if I don't get my way, or I'm not going to do this if I don't get my way, or these kind of power struggles that we have on these small levels. It's sad. But what's really sad to me is the preacher that allows it to happen and says, okay, I'll bow down. I don't understand that. I don't because my Bible doesn't say we should do that, right? We show no partiality. And a lot of times we think of this in terms of race or whatever else, but the bottom line is this. Anytime we elevate somebody above the crowd, that's showing partiality. Anytime we put somebody below the crowd, we say, well, they're less than human. They're less than us because of this, that, or the other. We're showing partiality. And James says very clearly, don't do that. It's wrong, right? Showing partiality compounds one party's sin with your own. And this is the problem I have, especially as a pastor and talking with other pastors who've had to deal with this. And I don't want to be in that situation. I don't like that situation. I get it. But where you're having to, you know, deal with competing ideas and fights and whatnot, and you're stuck in the middle, as a leader, as a church leader, I have to be impartial. Because if I'm not, then I'm guilty of being a judge with evil thoughts. And you should chastise me at that point as a congregation. If you see me being partial to one party or another, you should chastise me at that point. But likewise, if you come to me and you say, well, so-and-so is a horrible, no good person. Well, welcome to reality. We're all horrible, no good in some way or form or fashion. But God calls us to forgive one another and show mercy to one another. And it's hard at times. Don't get me wrong. It's hard. I'm human. I have my favorites. There's some humans around here that are less favorite than others. But we have to work together on this to show mercy, because that's the standard that we're going to, right? We're going for God's standard, not our own. All right, let's move on. Let's read 8 through 13. So if you really fulfill the royal law, according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. If you do not commit adultery but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. So we have this where James goes back to, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And what I love about this is that he's going all the way back to Leviticus. Now, a lot of us, we give Jesus credit for saying you should love your neighbor as yourself. That's kind of the popular thing. And yes, Jesus did come up with that, but he didn't do it necessarily when he walked this earth. If you turn back to Leviticus 19, it'll be on the screen too. I'm just going to read it from the screen. But Leviticus 19, 17 through 18, in part of the law, it says, you shall not hate your brother in your heart, but you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Right? This Levitical law, love your neighbor as yourself. This is one of those times where a lot of times we think Old Testament, New Testament are very different from each other. They're actually very much the same. It's the same story, the same God revealing himself. Here, it's explained, right? Leviticus in the law, don't hate your brother in your heart, right? Reason frankly with your neighbor. If you're at odds with somebody, reason with them. Reason frankly. Be honest about that. You don't have to be a jerk, but you do have to be honest about what's going on. Notice, lest you incur sin because of him. This is one of those things about life. Somebody else's sin will drag us down very quickly if we're not careful. Now, if you had, you know, parents like mine, it was always make sure you have good friends because you don't want your friends dragging down. But it's even when they're not your friends, their sin can drag you down, because if you allow their sin to engender hate and bitterness in your own heart, then you've incurred sin as well, right? Because you started to hate somebody, right? Don't take vengeance or bear grudge against the sons of your own people, right? This is why Lord said many times, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. We're not in the situation. We're not in the, it's not our role to take vengeance on somebody. Right, our role is to allow God to do the vengeful part. We uphold justice, we keep things on the up and up, but it's God who will take care of the punishing. Right, so then he says, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Right, showing partiality, it is a sin just as egregious as murder, adultery, or any other. And I know a lot of times we think, well, how can that be? Right, murder, that's killing somebody, that's horrible. Adultery, you're cheating on your spouse, right? That's horrible. How can partiality be on the same level with that? Well, going back to James, right? If you show partiality, you're committing sin and you're convicted by the law as transgressors. And then verse 10, whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. This is one of those things we don't like to think about, but every sin is just as egregious as any other. And so even partiality, even those sins of hate and bitterness towards people, regardless of what it is, maybe they are guilty. Maybe they're just a horrible human being. There's horrible human beings in the world. But it's not our role to hate and loathe them and show bitterness to them. It's our role to show light to them and show mercy. You say, well, they don't deserve mercy. Well, neither did we. They don't deserve grace. You're right, neither did we. I was handed a book recently titled Being Unoffendable is what it's called. I haven't finished it on purpose because it's a hard read. But I'll give you the gist of it because I got the gist of it and I thought, well, I'm putting that down. But the gist of the book is this. God has demonstrated so much mercy to us that we have no right to be unmerciful to those around us. And so unoffendable, meaning I can't be offended by so-and-so and what they've done because I've offended a holy God far worse than they offended me. That's a hard lesson. It's one I'm still learning. That's why I put the book down. But, I mean, this is what James is saying to us, right? If you really fulfill the whole law, right? I love how he says, if you really. Like, okay, you really think you're doing a good job. You really think you're a good Christian. Oh, you're Mr. Mature Christian. Okay, if you've really done that, all right, that's good. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. You're doing well. But if you show partiality, you've committed sin. This is the worst indictment to the holier-than-thous. When I'm talking to people and they're like, oh, church is just filled with holier-than-thou people. Not in my church, because they typically don't last long, because I'm very offensive to the holier-than-thou people. Because it's life, it's reality. We've all messed up. The sooner we're honest about that, the sooner we can move on with our lives and bask in the mercy of God. Right, showing partiality is sin just as egregious. Jesus said it this way, Matthew 5, 23 to 24, right? Jesus says, so if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. This is probably the worst thing you can tell a church for church attendance, right? Right? Before you come to church, before we ever do the call to worship, if there's anybody that you have offended or that has offended you, go and be reconciled before you come into the church service. It kind of makes you wonder how many would show up, right? If we did that honestly. But this is where we're at. And Jesus is talking to those that, I mean, everything was tied to the altar. Everything was tied to the offering. You know, this is Old Testament. I got to bring my animals to sacrifice. But before I do any of that, I'm going to leave it at the altar and then go and try and be reconciled with who I'm at odds with. That's the seriousness that Jesus lays on this. And so when James says things like, don't show partiality, be reconciled to one another, right? This is with the seriousness that he's talking about. And then later in Matthew 6, 14 through 15, in Matthew 6, we have the Lord's Prayer, right? Beautiful prayer. At the end of that, though, right? Or not in the end, but in the middle, y'all remember that line? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Or if you learn it in KJV like I did, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And this is one of those hard teachings, right? Because Jesus says, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And we read the story of the wicked servant who was unforgiving to those that owed him something. And this is a hard teaching. And for those of y'all that are wondering, where am I going with this? Keep in mind, Romans 8, 1, it's not in there. But, you know, there is now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. That's still in the Bible. And that's still a promise that I hold dear. But at the same time, I cannot ignore when Jesus says, if you're unwilling to forgive other people, your heavenly Father is not going to forgive you. And James, right, if you're doing well, if you keep the whole law, that's good. But, so to speak, act in those that are judged under the law. Look at verse 13. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Right? These are hard teachings. So if you're wondering how I reconcile this is how I kind of think about it. when we get to heaven, if we're in Christ, we're going to make it to heaven, right? And that's good. But there's some type of reckoning that happens. And I don't know what that looks like. I just know I don't want that really awkward moment where I'm standing at the gates of heaven. I'm looking and everything is glorious and I'm excited and I'm like, yes, I'm done with earth. Here we are. New heaven, new earth. Here I come. And the gates open up and I see Jesus face to face and I'm just like, Lord, I'm so thankful I'm here. And he says, I'm thankful you're here too. Before you come in though, take a seat. We need to have a talk. I mean, just imagine, like, I'm sorry, what? Right? That's, you know, and it's not that I'm afraid of that talk. It's just, if I can avoid it, all the better, right? Like, if I can live this life where when the gates open and he says, well done, my good and faithful servant, come on in, that's a whole lot better than, you tried your best, but hang on a second before you come in. Because if you come in right away, you might be a little uncomfortable to see who you see. That's what he's talking about here. That we have to, yes, we rest in the promise that Christ saves, and once you're saved, you're always saved. But we also have to understand that if we are unwilling to forgive people, that should be a giant red flag for our salvation. That perhaps we haven't experienced God's love as much as we say we do. Or maybe we haven't surrendered to Christ like we say we have. Because, again, judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. But there is good news, and James adds it on the end, right? Mercy triumphs over judgment. The good news is this. If you find yourself, and in your heart of hearts, and you've prayed, God, search my heart, show me my iniquity, show me where I have failed you, and God says, you're doing pretty good, but you're unmerciful and you're unforgiving, you need to work on that. There's mercy for you too. That you can be merciful because God will show you mercy. You can show grace to people around you because God will show you that grace. And when we've experienced that grace and we've experienced that mercy, it makes it a whole lot easier to forgive other people. And even those that have wronged us in the most hateful and shameful of ways, we can still show them mercy and forgiveness because we have hurt God in the most shameful and harmful of ways. But God says, I love you anyway. Our ability to reconcile with others is directly tied to our salvation. But again, I'm not saying that you lose your salvation. I'm just simply saying this. If you find yourself unwilling or unable to at least attempt to reconcile, right? And Paul did say, do your best to work with other people. Do your best to be with others, right? You're doing your best. It's not always going to work because reconciliation, it is a two-way street, right? If I hate you, you hate me, and I say, look, I want us to move on. I want to forgive you. I want you to forgive me, and I want us to move on together. If you're unwilling to do that, I've done my part. There's nothing else I can do. But if you're in that situation where somebody comes to you and says, look, I'm really sorry for these things that have happened. And you know what? You might have done some hurtful things too, but I want us to move past that. If you're unwilling to say, you know what? Yeah, let's move on. Let's forgive each other and move on. There's a problem there. And the wisdom of James, right, it points us to a fault in our character that we need to work on. And I think in this day and age, where everybody's mad about everything, and some of us are mad at others about things we don't even have control over, this would be a good time for us to sit back and just say, you know what? We're God's people. Maybe we should act like that. That's why it's at verse 12. Right? I love how he says it. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. Right? If you know that there is a reckoning for this life, if you know that Christ has come to save you, but you also know that Christ is calling you to a higher standard, he's calling you to a higher law, a law of liberty that actually brings freedom to others, and we're unable to act as though we live under that law, you know, James is like, just do that. You say, well, I don't know if I can. Well, salvation's on the line. Maybe you should try. You know, and again, go to Christ. This is why we go to the Holy Spirit for these things. And here's the other part, the last part. When we reconcile with our fellow humans, we demonstrate the reality of the gospel. I go back to the gospel. The good news is this. Even though you have sinned, even though I have sinned, even though we have egregiously offended a good and holy God, the Lord of heaven and earth, your creator, he forgives you because he sent his son to die for you. He laid down his life and he rose again on the third day, and that his resurrection proves that yes, he has power over sin and death. Yes, he has power to forgive you. He can do all the things that he's promised because he's even conquered the grave. That is freely given to anyone who will surrender. That's the good news of the gospel. And anytime one of us who has been reconciled to God, we surrender to him, we say, yes, I have faith, and this is why I'll be in heaven because of Christ. Anytime one of us goes to somebody else who also is reconciled to God, who also has surrendered to Christ, and even if we can't agree about anything else, if we can at least agree that Jesus is Lord and he wants us to work together and forgive one another, if we can at least do that, then we've demonstrated the reality of the gospel. This is why Jesus said, they'll know you by your love. How do they know that we're Christians? How do they know that we really do serve the risen Lord? How do they know that the things in this Bible are true and it's not just some nice story? Because we love one another and we forgive one another and we show mercy to one another and we don't show partiality. And we definitely don't do it in the church of all places. That's the reality of the gospel and how it works. And if you think to yourself, preacher, why are you so mean? I'm just reading the book. Because it hurts. Like I said, I'm human too. It hurts sometimes. Because when God points out, hey, those people that I've called you to teach, those people that I've called you to lead, those people I've called you to be friends with, right? Whenever you're unable to do that, it hurts. I'll never forget teaching in Southwest Little Rock of all places. And I was definitely the odd duck in that room. And I remember going home one day, and I didn't even make it in the house. I just prayed, God, how in the world am I supposed to teach these kids? These are the most unloving, unforgiving, pains in the butt kids I've ever seen in my life. And I heard God say, welcome to my world. These are the ones that need you most. And then I had other people reinforce it. Don't you hate that? You're just talking to somebody, and the thing that you heard God say in your head, you're like, I don't know if he said that. I really hope he didn't say that. And then you're just talking to some random person, and they tell you the same thing. Oh, I can't stand that. Because it's those hard lessons that make us better. But man, it's hard when it happens. So whenever we come to James, and I'll be honest, he's only in chapter 2. Just buckle your seatbelts for the rest of it, right? But when we get to these hard lessons in the scripture, we're at a crossroads. This is where we decide, okay, am I really going to follow Christ? Or am I just going to do what I've been doing and hope it works out anyway? This is where we're at. For those of y'all that have never turned your life to Christ, it's real simple, and I'd love to talk more with you about it. But if you have, just pray the prayer of Psalms, right? Search my heart, O God. Show me my iniquity. Show me where I failed. And if you're willing to pray that and you're willing to listen, then God is also willing to tell you and to guide you into new life. And here's the thing. When we get those hard lessons right, I've experienced it myself. When you can move past those hardest of lessons, it just opens up a whole new world that God has for us. And it's a great and good world if we're willing to follow him. But let's pray. Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you for this opportunity to read your word. We thank you for your servant James, who was willing to give us the hard lessons. Because that's what they needed then, and that's what we need now. Lord, I pray that as we look at this lesson, that for any of us that think we can't do it on our own, that we don't have the moral fortitude or the character strength or just the Christian grit necessary to live this kind of forgiving and mercy-filled life, remind us that your Holy Spirit is in us, and he will guide us, and he will point us in the right direction. He will give us the words to say, Father, help us to understand that there is so much in store for us if we are only willing to surrender to you. Or if there's anyone here who has never turned to you, if they are still wondering what it means to follow Christ, give them the boldness to step up and step out and just ask, what does it mean to be saved? Or there's so many of us here that would love to share with them what that means. We thank you again. In Jesus' name, amen.